Good morning, Ridgecrest Family Church, and welcome to another service live from the church. And we can't wait to welcome you all back into the church. Right now we're heading to an awesome time as we welcome back our Epi Kids ministry. But first, if you're new to us, go subscribe to our YouTube channel and check us out on Facebook to keep up to date with what's going on in the life of the church. But right now, get excited, Epi Kids is back, and we want to minister to you and your family in this time, and especially to your kids. So get ready.
Concentrating on one big idea. So stay tuned for that.
I know that we are entering a very busy time of year. So instead of workbooks, we've devised a single sheet based on the lesson. We did send it to you earlier this week, so we hope you have them at the ready.
Perfect. Oh, and don't forget, we had two birthdays this week, both on Wednesday. So happy birthday to you, Cooper Marshall and Sayana Stain. So, as promised, we want to share our big idea with you. So here it goes. Faith means you can believe in things you can't even see. So, say it with me. Faith means you can believe in things you can't even see.
But hold on, what is faith? It's not an easy word to understand. Like, if you said chocolate, I could picture it. Or even better still, a McFlurry.
Ooh, it has to be an Oreo one.
Definitely. Oh. I can picture it. I can almost even taste it.
Yeah.
But faith, I'm not seeing or tasting it.
But don't worry. I have the dictionary right here.
Oh.
Like I believe it is, it must be right.
Sure it is.
Whew. Okay.
What does it say?
Faith is the belief in or devotion to or trust in somebody or something without logical proof.
Eish, that sounds confusing.
No. That's what the dictionary says. But here, let me explain it this way. Here's my cell phone.
It's over there.
Here's my cell phone.
Okay.
Yeah. So, do you think you can find a picture of a McFlurry?
Oh yeah, for sure.
How can you do that?
You just use the internet.
But can you see the internet?
No, of course not. It's invisible.
But then, how do you know that you can download a picture on it?
Because it's been done millions of times before. Everybody knows that the internet exists and it works. So, you go ahead and voila!
Oh, okay. I get it. So, that's exactly how you know about faith. It's believing in something that you can't see, but you know it's real.
Our memory verse talks about exactly this, so we've asked Lee to explain it to us. Listen up, kids.
Good morning, boys and girls. I hope you're well, I hope you're safe, and I hope you're enjoying the lovely weather that we experienced in these past few days. Today I'd like to ask, If your mums and dads know of a very important verse in the Bible which refers to great people of faith, do you know if they know? Let's find out, or even better, let's teach them. Today I'll be talking to you about Hebrews 11 verses 1. How easy is that to remember? Do it with me. Hebrews 11 verses 1. That's right. Now, Hebrews 11 verses 1 says the following. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we can't see. Hey, what was that? Let's try it again. Hebrews 11 verses 1 says, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we can't see. Remember that and go tell mom and dad. Let's see if we can remember this as our memory verse for the week. Enjoy your day, everybody. Keep well. Bye.
Thanks, Lee. We actually exercise faith every day. Isn't it pretty dim in here? Mm-hmm. Hey, MCK, can you turn the lights on, please? Much better. Did you see the electricity that made that go on?
Of course not. It's invisible.
So in this case, the hope that you were sure of was...
that the light would go on.
And the thing that you were certain was, even though you couldn't see it, was...
the electricity.
Ha! You got it, Einstein. That's what faith is.
Hold on, guys. I have a challenge for you. Look behind you and you will see two feathers there. Let's see who can keep their feather up the longest, just using your breath.
Oh goodness.
Are you ready? Position yourselves.
We're ready.
And go.
It's still up. It's still up.
I
was harder than I thought.
I think the winner was Leanne. Holding up the feathers?
Well, our breath.
Our breath.
Are you sure it was your breath? I couldn't see your breath.
Yes.
Didn't you see us keeping the feathers afloat?
You're talking about the evidence that was able to keep the feathers in the air. So, moving air.
Did you know that a lot of people say God doesn't exist because we can't see him? But we know that the evidence of God is all around us.
So, tell us about it, Matthew and Kate.
Morning, church. One way that we know God exists is in his beautiful creation. Psalms 19 verses 1 tells us, the heavens keep telling the wonders of God, and the skies declare the works of his hands. That's it. We can clearly see God through his wonderful creation.
Morning, friends. Another way we know God exists is through people. In Genesis 2, it says, so God created man in his image, male and female. We see God evidence in the lives of his people.
But hold on. Remember our big idea?
Even I remember. Faith means believing in things,
even if we can't see them.
Noah sure had to believe in a lot of things he couldn't see. He was asked to build an ark.
In fact, the Bible tells us that he is in the Hall of Fame for having faith. Take a look.
The Faithful Hall of Fame, Hebrews 11. Noah! This is Noah. Noah is in the Hall of Fame because he obeyed God. God looked over all the earth, and he saw that everything they thought or imagined was evil. So God was sorry that he had made such a wicked people and wanted to start over. But Noah found favor with God. So God told Noah to build an ark. He told Noah exactly how to build the ark, and it was to be the biggest boat ever built. Then, God told Noah to fill the ark with two of every kind of animal. God told Noah to get into the ark with his family. So Noah obeyed and did everything exactly as God had told him.
Now, just think a moment. Noah had every reason not to have faith in God's command. He had never even seen rain before.
Really?
Yep.
Imagine that.
And he didn't even know what a boat was. And then God said, go build a boat.
And he would have to make sure that all the lots and lots and lots of animals would fit inside the boat. He exercised a lot of faith.
Would you have listened to God if you had been Noah?
I don't think so, hey.
Hey kids, would you have listened to God if you had been Noah?
It boils down to our Bible verse, remember it? It's being sure of what we hope for and certain of things that we can't see, exactly like Noah did.
Well, I think there is no better person to sum this all up than Douglas.
Just because you can't see something does not mean it isn't there. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas. And have you ever ridden in a plane? Like flown through the sky in a plane? I got to ride in a plane once. Well, actually, I got to ride in a plane twice because we flew down to Florida to visit some of my parents' friends and then we flew back. So I guess I flew down one time and then back another time. But it was all within like, you know, a week and a half. Anyways, I was kind of nervous getting on the plane for the first time, and we have all the baggage stuff, and we gotta, you know, crawl through this plane trying to get to our seats. And I sit down, and I got to have a window seat, and I could see out the window, and I could see the wing of the plane, and I could see the ground, and you know, as we're starting to take off, you know, it's kind of rumbling, and we get up into the sky, and I could look down out the window, and it was so cool. The world looked like a giant quilt. Like I could see the farms around my town, and they looked like a big old quilt on the ground, and I could see the clouds, and we got to a point where we flew up above the clouds, and we could see the clouds beneath us, and it was just amazing. But at a certain point, I was looking down, and I could see the wing, and I kind of looked down into my seat, and I could see I was sitting on a seat. I was on something, right? But as I'm looking out at the wing, I'm realizing the plane is on nothing. It's flying through the air. And this idea just kind of broke my little brain. We were flying through the air and we were supported by nothing. The plane was sitting on nothing, which is not exactly true because the plane is sitting on air, sort of. You know, it's flying through the air. It is using air to keep itself up. And you can't see the air, but the plane is definitely using the air. If the air wasn't there, you know, this plane, it wouldn't be able to get up off the ground. And, you know, it's not just that air is, you know, it keeps planes and birds up in the sky, but air keeps us alive too. We can't see it, but you breathe in and you breathe out all day, every day. The air you breathe keeps us alive, but you can't see it. Sometimes you can see stuff that it moves around. You know, if the wind blows and rustles some leaves, you see the leaves moving, but you don't see the air. And it's that way with God too. You can't usually see God, but he's there. And he's not just there, but he is necessary for life. And through him, we can do some pretty incredible things. You know, even more incredible than a huge plane flying through the air. Through God, all things are possible. And when you put your trust in something that you can't see, that's called faith.
Hey kids, we hope you've got it. You can have awesome faith like Noah and believe in our unseen but very real God.
Thanks for tuning in this morning. We are going to play out with a song called My Faith Is In You. You will find the words in the back of your one pager so you can read along or sing along as we affirm that our faith is in Jesus.
God made everything that I see. By his word this world came to be. When I doubt, I know he's with me. Well, I know. God made everything that I see. By his word this world came to be. When I doubt, I know he's with me. Well, I know. My faith is in you. I know that you are true. When I can't see, you are real. No matter what I feel, there's proof.
No mystery, my faith is in you.
What a great time for ministry with our kids. But now as we enter into worship, let's just quieten our hearts and as I read scripture, just get ready for the message from Dr. Dez and worship. Hebrews 11 verse 7. By faith Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. And now as we get ready for worship, let's just bow our heads. Lord, we come before you and we're just so grateful that we have the privilege because of what your son did to come before you. Lord, I pray as we each person engages with the message, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just work in their lives, Lord, that any distractions, whether it be financial difficulties or relational issues, that you would just allow them to fix their eyes on what your word says, Lord, and that your word may bring life to where there is none. Lord, I pray that you would just be with each person here, Lord, and allow them to really encounter you through the service, Lord. Lord, I pray that everything done will be for your glory first of all, Lord. Lord, I pray that each person engaging with the content would bow before you, Lord, that they would just have their hearts set on you. Lord, I pray that as we go through what 2020 has given us, Lord, that we may remember that you are in control completely. Lord, I pray that if there's anyone struggling, that they would be able to reach out to the rest of us, Lord, that they may reach out to the church, Lord, and that we may comfort them and be the body in this time, Lord. I pray that you would strengthen each of your children to selfless service, Lord, that we may give to others and that we may comfort in this time, Lord, through your strength. And Lord, I pray that as we sit on a Sunday, as we look to the rest of the week, that we, through the service, may fix our eyes on you so that for the rest of the week, our eyes are fixed on what it needs to be fixed on. Lord, I pray this in your name. Amen.
We are children of the very Most High God, and because of that, we have the freedom to wait and expect for him to fulfill on his promises. And so, won't you share with us as we worship God this morning together?
Sunset's free, oh, is free. Yeah.
cross, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Yes, Lord, we know that we look forward to an eternity in your house. But we're so thankful that even in this life, we can identify as children of the Most High God. That is who we are. And because of that, Lord, we can have faith in you. We can trust in you. We can believe in you as being the one who is faithful and just, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and who can fulfill his promises. Thank you, Lord. We glorify you this morning. In Jesus' name. And so we're going to sing a song. It's called Yes and Amen. And it celebrates the fact that we serve a God who is faithful, a God whose promises are yes and amen. Why don't you join with us as we worship?
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you filled me with peace. A giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are, and faithful forever you will be, and faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen.
What do you think about that this morning? We serve a God who is faithful.
A beautiful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes. You have broken every curse, and blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. And faithful you are, and faithful.
is our yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen.
Won't you just take a moment this morning? Just think about the God you serve and how He is faithful. He is all powerful. He can fulfill every word. Faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Faith can move the mountains. Let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. You're the Lord of all creation. Still you know my heart. You're the author of salvation. You loved us from the start. Waiting here for you. With our hands lifted high. It's you we adore, singing hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you're everything. Faithfulness is true. We're desperate for your presence. All we need is you. We're waiting for you.
We're waiting here for you. With our hands lifted high. It's you we adore, singing hallelujah.
sing that verse again. You're a God who's faithful. Everything you've promised. And we wait in anticipation in your very presence this morning, O God. Firmly rooted in the fact that we are your children. And we know that you are faithful. Just sing with us, waiting here for you.
Waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore, singing high.
Let's pray together. Lord, we are waiting expectantly for you right now. And we pray, Father, that as we hear from your word, you would speak to us and that our hearts would be attentive to you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, that our faith is rooted in you and not in some abstract idea or in our own ability to have faith in something, Lord. And so strengthen our faith today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning to you and welcome to Ridgecrest Family Church Online. It is so good to have another Sunday online, and likely next Sunday, many of you will join us here at Ridgecrest Family Church building. That's going to be quite exciting. For the first time in 6 months, I've been to the church building. But you know, of course, that the church is more than just the building. It is the people, it is you, it is I, who make up the body of Christ and the local church. And so just pay attention to some of the details around that. And we look forward to seeing some of you here next week if you're able to make it. Just note that if you feel like you need a time of prayer or want to just reach out to someone for some counsel, we have two of our leaders who are online ready to engage with you. Mark and Milani are online right now. And so if you would like to just pray with someone or just have some counsel, please do not hesitate to reach out. Another week has passed. Can you believe it? 7 days. And here we are together just to worship the Lord together. It's such a joy to be able to meet in these kinds of ways online and see so many people who may not have originally come to Ridgecrest joining us online. And so you might have been the first, this might be your first Sunday on YouTube or Facebook or wherever you're watching from. And we'd like to really welcome you to the Ridgecrest Family Church. I'd really appreciate your prayers for us this week. This week we have our very first Global Virtual Connect Summit, which is an evangelist summit. And it's really exciting to see that we have about 35 nations represented in our English summit, which happens this next Wednesday, the 30th of September. If you're able to, I'd love for you to join in. It's a free event and some amazing speakers. We have Angus Buchan from South Africa, as well as Heinz Winkler, who will be performing some songs and speakers from all over the world, including Luis Palau. It's going to be a really amazing time, jammed between two sessions. We have a breakout session so you can interact with other people and learn more. And so I see Pastor Ezra is registered, but it'd be so great to see if there are others in Ridgecrest who also would like to register. I'd love to have you there as well. We do a Spanish one on the 17th of October, and awesome to see 18 of the 22 nations represented from Latin America. The French one happens in January. So pray for us as we seek to elevate evangelism around the world. But today we're focusing on the series regarding faith, and so we're going to be looking at Hebrews 11 and verse 7, specifically looking at the person of Noah. But before we get there, just a story to kind of get us started. One of the things that I love hearing, or one of the questions that I love answering that people ask very often, is how did you and Lara meet, and how did you end up getting married? For me, this is one of the greatest stories of Lara having faith in the unseen, right? We met in high school. And how this worked was, in grade 8, when Lara saw me, she thought to herself, Desmond is the guy that I believe I'm going to marry. How's that? Faith in the unseen, right? She went home and she told her family and her brothers, Mom and Dad, I've met the guy that I'm going to marry one day. She had quite an amazing sense of faith. Faith in the unseen, because we weren't even friends then. So I don't know how we were going to get married if we didn't even know about each other, really, in many ways. Then she made the mistake of telling me that she liked me, but more than that, telling me that God said that we're going to get married. Now that's crazy, a grade 10 kid hearing some girl say, God says to me, we're going to get married. I thought she was insane, and I avoided her for a few years. But then again, God brought us together again, and in my final year of school, God did a work in my heart, which was absolutely amazing, and I realized that God had called me to full-time ministry. And so it was really pretty cool to be able to come together. Laura served at a local church, the Church of the Nazarene at that time, as a youth leader. I served at Florida Baptist as a youth leader there. And we connected in that kind of way, bringing young people together from different churches. That was really cool. And then I never forget this day with Pastor Norman Schaefer and his big banana fingers, massive fingers, in his office. Young man, don't you know what you've got right in front of you? And he challenged me to see what Lara already knew to be true, right? And so I kind of got the picture eventually, and what was unseen became clear to me in many, many ways. And so we've been happily married for 14 years this year, and I couldn't be happier for Lara's faith in the unseen. Funny story, but I think it's helpful for us to ground us in the text that we're going to be looking at today. I'd like to ask you, perhaps, where is your faith right now? Are you fumbling around in the darkness? Are you fearing what others are thinking? Are you fearing the circumstances you're in? Are you allowing the circumstances you're in to get the better of you? Today, we're going to answer the all-important question, how does faith in God's promises lead to a transformed life? How does faith in God's promises lead to a transformed life? And in our short time, we're going to be exploring aspects of the life of Noah that I believe will encourage you, but will also lead you and I to realize yet again that God saves us by faith and calls us to live a life of obedience and a life of righteousness. God calls us to these two things. And so we've already come to see in this series that faith is a vital part of the Christian life. In fact, the writer to the Hebrews puts it this way, without faith, it is impossible to please God. You can't please God with your good looks. You can't please God with your money. You can't please God with your fashion. You can't please God with anything other than faith. Faith is an important part of being a believer. You see, we approach God by faith. Ephesians 2 speaks about this. Paul says, you've been saved by grace through faith. This is not of your own. It is the gift of God. That's the joy of the Christian faith. It's not something we earn. and is the gift of God. God graciously gives to us these things. But we're also called to live our life by faith alone. Again, Paul in 2 Corinthians puts it this way: our walk is by faith and not by sight. Just like Laura looked at me and saw something in the future that God had really shown her, and she acted on that, so we as believers are called to do the same. We're called through faith in God to look into the future, and through hope and faith and trust in Him to live our life in this way. But here's the thing, faith in itself is useless, right? Faith and your ability to believe that something can happen doesn't necessarily translate to it happening. You see, we don't have faith in faith, but we have faith in God, a person who is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. God never changes, and our faith, when put in the person of Jesus Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit, can do unbelievable and amazing things. Today, Pastor Ezra has asked me to look at the life of Noah and explore how his faith can encourage our walk with the Lord. We can always learn from people, ordinary people in the Bible that God uses in extraordinary ways. Now, Noah is mentioned a few times in the Bible. In fact, in the book of Genesis, Moses dedicates 4 chapters to the life of Noah. We read about him in some of the historical books of the Old Testament and in the prophets of the Old Testament. Matthew and Luke pick up on Noah. And then, of course, Peter, the apostle, uses Noah in a very particular way in the New Testament when he speaks about the second coming of Jesus Christ and relates the times of Noah to the same times that we'll see when Jesus comes again. And so Noah is the 10th generation in the line of Adam. We read in the book of Genesis, in the line of Seth. His father, Lamech, gave him the name Noah, which literally in the Hebrew text translates to rest or to find rest, in the hope that he would one day bring relief to the ground that was cursed because of Adam's disobedience. Noah lived in a particular context, much like we live in a context right now. Noah lived in a context that was described as utterly evil and wicked. In fact, God looks at the earth and all that He had created to be good, and He wanted to destroy it completely. In fact, as He looks at creation, all He saw that was righteous and good in His sight was one man, Noah, one family. And in fact, God saved this one man and his family, 8 people in this ark with animals, and restarted humanity as a result. And so, yes, I do believe that there was a universal flood. I believe that what we see in Scripture is absolutely true. This is not just some kind of cute story that we tell our kids in Sunday school. This is real stuff. And if you look at geology and different aspects of science, you can see how this confirms the Bible and what we believe to be true as believers. And I'm deeply encouraged by this. But Noah lived in a time described as wicked. In Genesis 6 and verse 5, specifically, every intent of the thoughts of their heart were evil continuously. Doesn't that sound like our day and age? We live in the same time that is so wicked. Sometimes I just want to pinch myself when I see things on Facebook and on the news. Are we really, really going through these times? Are people really like this? Maybe you've experienced it in your own life. Maybe you've been a victim of the wicked times we live in. God knows what you're going through right now. Yet in the midst of this time, there was one man who stood out. Noah, one man who had faith and was known for his radical obedience to God and his promises, and that was Noah. One man who was persistent in the purpose that God had called him for, and that was Noah. I wonder, would you and I be able to stand for God in the way that Noah did? Would you and I persist in the unseen? In the unseen. You see, there was a real difference between Noah and those around him in the world, right? Is there a difference in your life compared to those who do not follow Jesus? I'm often so challenged by this. And I want to ask you really to think about, what is the difference between you and your neighbor who does not know Jesus? What is the difference? If I had to compare you and your neighbor who does not follow Jesus Christ, what would the difference be? Is it in the way you speak? Is it in the way you conduct your business? Is it just that you come to church on a Sunday and they don't? Is it in your ethics, the way you conduct yourself, your what you value? Is it even in your marriage and in your family? I really wonder what the difference is in our lives as we compare ourselves to the world around us. You see, Jesus wants there to be a difference in our lives. Being a believer means that we don't just come to church on Sunday, we don't just say a prayer, raise our hand, accept Jesus into our hearts, and then live our life as a son of hell. That's not what God had in mind. There is a radical nature to the gospel, a radical nature. There is a death and a rebirth, right? And so we die to ourselves and we live to Christ. What do we learn from Hebrews 11 and verse 7? Well, turn with me. Let's read it right now. Hebrews 11 and verse 7, one short verse. By faith, Noah, after he was warned about what was not yet seen and motivated, notice this, by godly fear, he feared the Lord. Look at that. He built an ark to deliver his family. By faith, he condemned the world. He set the world aside and he became an heir of righteousness that comes by faith. Well, there are three points that I want to bring out, and I'm going to do this pretty quickly, so I hope you're with me. The first one is simply this, that faith in God demands total commitment. Faith in God demands total commitment. I remember one of my first pastorates was at Grace Community Church and just graduated from college and serving the life of the church, and it was hard. We lived in Fourways at that time, and we were not earning what people in our congregation would necessarily have been earning. And it was very hard for me to kind of just, you know, accept that. And so I remember going to my uncle one day and I said to him, hey, like, I've got these business ideas. I want to start this on the side. And I was already working for an estate agent on the side. And they were gracious enough to pay me for some work I did for them. And all the time I was trying to be productive and provide for my family. But my uncle said something to me as a successful businessman. He said to me, Desmond, what I want you to do is forget about all these business ideas. You focus on becoming the best pastor that you can be, and God will bring you success. And I thought to myself, wow, that's an interesting perspective. I mean, you're an entrepreneur. You've made so much money through your different business activities. Like, don't you think I should know? You focus on being the best pastor that you can be. And so that's what I did. And this reminds me of Luke chapter 17, where Jesus says this in verse 33, whoever tries to make his life secure will lose it, but whoever loses his life will preserve it. This comes out of the context of Noah, because in verse 26, he reminds us, just as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the days of the Son of Man. Again, he reminds us of Lot. And as it was in the days of Lot, so will it be when the Son of Man will come. You see, Noah has no struggle or challenge with being viewed as, you know, as normal or successful in his own generation. Noah was committed to God, no matter what the cost. Whatever his life goal and aim was, that was completely changed when God came to him and instructed him to build the ark. The purpose that God brought into his life consumed him completely. For months and months, they built this monstrosity, not knowing what would really come. Yet, he demonstrated the principle of complete commitment to his Lord. You see, with Jesus, friends, it's all or nothing, right? You can't be a little committed or somewhat committed to Jesus. In the book of Revelation, John puts it this way, you're either hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm, that doesn't please God in any way. I'm reminded of the story of Julius Caesar, who landed on the shores of Great Britain, and he had his Roman legions with him, and he took a bold and decisive step to ensure the success of what would happen at that particular time. He ordered his men to march over to the cliffs of Dover and look out on the bay, and as they looked out, they saw something they never thought they would see. All of the ships were burnt and burning. Julius Caesar made a decisive step right there, saying to his men, there is no room for retreat. You can't turn back now. The only way is forward. And that's what they did. They marched forward and they were victorious in all that they did because of this action. I wonder, what ships do you need to burn in your own life to advance and obtain a victory in Christ? What things do you need to literally separate yourself from, set aside? I mean, I don't know what that is. Maybe it is your own greed that you need to set aside, your own career path, your own plan and desire to prosper. Set those things aside. Maybe it is sexual sin, and you need to set that aside. Maybe it is selfishness and your own desire for whatever that may be. We can so easily get caught up in sin. Set it aside. Burn that bridge and move on. Number two, we see in the life of Noah that obedience is a byproduct of our faith. Noah had faith in God, and his faith in God led him to obey the command of God. Now, obedience is not easy. Any of you who have kids know this. You know, obedience is so hard. Like, why do I have to shout before I get a response, right? Obedience is costly. Look at Jesus Christ and what it cost him on the cross. Yet the Bible says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. For the joy set before him. Obedience also brings ridicule sometimes to our lives. We can be ridiculed for the decisions we made. I mean, put yourself in Noah's shoes. Imagine no one had ever seen a boat before. No one ever thought of the flood like that it could happen in that kind of way. I mean, what is this guy doing? He's cutting down trees. He's not conserving nature. I mean, he's doing all kinds of crazy things. Why are you doing this? You're insane. You've lost your mind. Imagine what he must have felt like. Obedience to Christ is also countercultural. Paul says we're in the world, yet we're not of the world. Again, there has to be a difference in our lives. But what is worse is Noah obeyed God in what was unseen, not on what was seen. You see, what is seen is easy to obey, but what is unseen is sometimes very hard for us to obey and to walk in. Number three, in keeping with our time, faith and obedience results in right living. Right living. We have faith, we have obedience, and then we have righteousness. 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 Sin, the Bible says, is a reproach to any people, but righteousness exalts a nation. We need righteousness in our nation right now, but it doesn't start with our cabinets and our presidents and all of those in power above us. It starts with you right in your home, that you are righteous in the context of your family, righteous in the context of your marriage. It's easy for us to look at the politicians and criticize them for their lack of integrity when you yourself do not display any integrity in the way that you behave. It's easy for us to do that. You see, faith and obedience result in right living. That's what Noah was really known for. You see, twice in the book of Genesis, in Genesis 6 and Genesis 7, reports that Noah did everything according to the Lord, that the Lord had commanded him. Do we live our lives in the light of eternity? Do we live our lives in the light of eternity? What is it that you are known for? Are you known for being a righteous person? Are you known for being a follower of the living God? Or are you known for being a liar? For being a hypocrite? For being an adulterer? For being a blasphemer, a dog, a player? Maybe a narcissist or an abuser, a drunkard or a drug addict? Noah was described as a righteous man. How is it that people describe you? You see, there is no doubt that there is a parallel between the days of Noah and the time that we're living in right now. Wickedness is unleashed now more than ever. There's no boundaries. There's no limit to your sin. You could do whatever you please, right? In fact, it seems like that. Everyone does exactly what they please. But as we close this message, I want us to to think about a few questions that apply to our own lives. Firstly, do you see what God sees in the world? Do you see what God sees in the world? Do you see the world through his eyes? And then are you broken by what you see? Are you broken by what you see? Secondly, are you more likely to focus on what is seen or tangible rather than what is unseen and intangible? What does this reveal about your faith and your walk with God? Do you only obey God when you can see the benefit to yourself? Or do you obey God no matter what? Even if God calls you to something as ridiculous as building an ark, do you obey him? Do you walk in faith? Or are you governed by what you can see and by what you feel? Because those things can be so misleading. What will you be known for building when your life is over? You see, Noah was known as a man of righteousness, a preacher of righteousness, an heir of righteousness. His reward was great in heaven. He may not have known that on earth in many ways. There were struggles, there were difficulties. What is it that you'll be known for when you're gone? Maybe that's not something you've thought about too often. I wonder, very simply, will you boldly dare to win? I'm going through a devotional book written by a friend of mine, and this is no advert for him, but it's just such a great read, particularly for guys. 30 Days of Death or Glory, and just a great devotion that I think that will really bless you and encourage you. And in this book, he speaks about a story of the Special Air Service, that it is legendary in the exploits between World War II and going on from that. Their difficult training and the qualification course makes them one of the most elite special forces in the world. Their motto is in fact simply this: who dares wins. The meaning could not be clearer, right? It is those, not those who sit back who win. The one running slowly around the field is still faster than the one sitting on the couch, like me, right? Okay. The one who dares to share the gospel is far closer to seeing someone come to faith than a critic criticizing on social media. I'm encouraged by what William Carey, the sort of founder or founding father of missions, said: expect great things from God, but attempt great things for God. Who dares wins. What issue are you facing in your family, in your marriage, at your workplace, or even at church? He who dares wins. Apathy in these areas will not result in victory. Action is your only option for success. There can be no retreat, right? Because the ships have been burned. You can't go back. The only way to move is to go forward. Now, from there, consider where you are in battle or where even you might be losing in life. In all these areas, nothing will change unless you dare to ask, to seek, and to knock. Isn't that what Jesus says in Matthew 7 and verse 7? Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be open unto you. James, the brother of Jesus, writes these challenging words: whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. James 4 and verse 17. What is the right thing for you to do in your marriage? What is the right thing for you to do in your workplace, in your family, in your church, to make things better than they are right now? Don't come with excuses. Don't procrastinate. Don't deliberate about what you should do or could do. It is time for action. And it is again action and obedience to God that God, through that, bears amazing results in your life. Friends, God has made you who you are and has given your life, yes, your life, tremendous purpose. Just like God used Noah in the days to build the ark, to preserve humanity, and to restart things in this world, God desires to use you as you are wired. To end with these words, John 13 and verse 17: if you know these things, blessed are you that do them. You may know the right thing to do, but blessed are you that do them. Let's pray. Father God, may we be known as people of faith, people of obedience, and people of righteousness. Help us, Lord, to do it in this generation, and to glorify your name, we pray. Help us this week to live for you in every way. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. We are going to have a time of prayer. And so if you would want some prayer, please, right now, hit the chat and Milani and Mark will be with you and we'll pray with you. And so we're also going to be having our Park and Pray very soon. And so come and join us at 11 a.m. Be great to have you there. See you in a few.